Do not confuse our ability to attribute human characteristics to AI with a true technical breakthrough. A mock virtual psychotherapist named Eliza is a valuable lesson to contextualize the current AI boom. Eliza was a deceptively simple bot developed by Joseph Weizenbaum in the 1960s. Eliza, just a couple lines of code, would take the position of a text-based therapist. It would ask, "Is something troubling you?" After which it would identify a keyword in the user's response, "I'm feeling sad," and repeat it back as a question. "Is it important that you're feeling sad?" When it couldn't identify a keyword, it would simply say, "Please go on," or "Tell me more." This simple piece of logic led Eliza's users to divulge deep secrets to this virtual psychotherapist. Users seemed eager to attribute care and attention to a few short lines of code. Eliza listened. Eliza understood. But Eliza doesn't really understand. Eliza is less than human, less than a parrot even. Users are just fascinated to see aspects of themselves mirrored back to them. Humans do a lot of the legwork to make a chatbot feel human. It says more about the human ability to anthropomorphize than the technology's ability to be truly human. Conversational AI interfaces like ChatGPT, Bing, or Bard are fun to use, in part because they feel personable and somewhat human. Despite the surge in interest in human-like AI and the increase in the anthropomorphization of these models, computers inducing empathy in users is not new. It is not innovative, and it certainly doesn't require machine learning or AI. People are more likely to project human attributes like thinking and feeling onto interfaces when the context for interaction is more human-like. Researchers and programmers alike have used this trick to convince users of humanity, to convince them that opening their heart and divulging their secrets. So, what does this mean for the current field of AI development? Do not confuse satisfaction with function. A user may derive just as much enjoyment from an interface that reflects their thoughts and feelings as an interface which indexes the world's knowledge and provides meaningful insight. The difference is in the value, utility, and ease the interface provides. You may introduce anthropomorphic aspects into your AI products, and it may improve the product, but it would be disingenuous to attribute that to artificial intelligence, algorithmic, or machine learning improvements. In many ways, improving interfaces to be more enjoyable is exactly what UX professionals have been doing for decades.
Thanks for watching. If you want to see more of our UX videos, take a look at these over here and consider subscribing to our channel. On our website, nngroup.com, you can access our free library of over 2,000 articles. You can also register for one of our UX courses that offer live, hands-on UX training.